I'm Dr. Robert Bastian. If you have an established diagnosis of spasmodic dysphonia, yet a standard treatment, botulinum toxin injection, is not working well for you, then this video is for you. Most people with SD are happy with the benefit they achieve with Botox, but for various reasons, some aren't. Maybe they can't get in for an injection when they need it, or perhaps every injection is unusually painful, or perhaps something very different happens after some injections or even all of their injections. Another reason might be that early side effects after each injection, breathy voice and coughing on liquids in particular, are intolerable. Well, let's work through these and other issues by building a list of things that you can work on together with your doctor in order to make Botox work better for you. First on the list is to realize that Botox injections must be available as soon as possible, within 2 weeks of your request, even when you need to move an appointment forward on short notice. That would be ideal. Otherwise, sheer lack of access to Botox when you need it or when it best fits your schedule can be frustrating. If you really need Botox, sometimes you need it now. The entire visit, of course, needs to occur in a short period of time so that you're not burdened by the inconvenience of the injection itself. The injection procedure needs to be done skillfully to minimize discomfort, and that includes optimizing the use of anesthesia. Those with difficult anatomy can be an exception, but otherwise, injections should be straightforward and brief. The results should be relatively consistent, signifying that Botox in the syringe, here, the Botox that's in the barrel of the syringe, actually reaches through the needle and into the actual muscle. So that's what gives us consistent injections, is when what's in the syringe reaches the target muscle. And that needs to be reasonably accurate each time. Now, a small amount of variability is expected and normal because it isn't possible for anyone to place that medication in exactly the same place every time. It's even more difficult with the abductory variant because the muscle isn't here, but it's behind the larynx right there, and that's even more challenging technically and can make for some increase in variability. There's also a special challenge for persons who need only tiny doses of Botox, because a tiny dose also means if a tiny volume. So we might have a tiny amount like that, and it's a little bit like tossing only one beanbag to win the prize at the fair rather than increasing your chances by throwing several. Now, another early issue with Botox satisfaction is when early side effects are more than mild to moderate. So if this is my SD voice, then I want my early voice to be like this, so that it's still very functional but kind of weak. Or maybe even I'd take it like this, but never so weak that you have to take time off work or that you feel very frustrated by the Botox effects. In other words, you're just trading one kind of bad voice problem, SD, for another bad voice problem, which is an exceedingly weak voice. Now, here's an important strategic issue that's really, in a way, up to you. Injections are best done on a regular schedule, and it's going to be different for different people, but the average might be 16 weeks or 3 times a year. Whatever your personal best interval is should become clear after you've had a number of injections. There are some people whose muscles seem to overcome the effects of Botox kind of quickly, and so a very small group of people have to come as often as 10 or 12 weeks apart. That's not very common, but once in a while. There are other people who, on the other end of the spectrum, seem to metabolize the Botox very slowly. And for them, they might only be coming every 20 weeks. They're the really fortunate ones. But again, typical would be 16 weeks. Whatever, though, your personal best interval, the rhythm of the injections needs to represent season tickets and not a per performance kind of strategy. And I think those who try to stretch the injections as far apart as possible are usually more frustrated than those who get on a schedule and they do a little undulation of their voice like this, rather than it's bad and then it's better and then it's really bad. So that's just a strategy that you can think about for yourself. Now, you might need access to a voicemail where you can leave a voice sample for your physician or your speech pathologist. He or she can then listen to your comments or questions, especially after your first one or two or three injections, but they're also listening to the sound of your voice, and then they can communicate back with you, either personally or, in my case, more often through staff. I can answer questions and make comments about what I think might be a better strategy for the next injection. Now, persons with abductory SD leave not only a voice sample, but they should also, on the telephone while they're talking, they should then, or while they're on the phone, I should say, they should exhale fully, empty their lungs, and then breathe in as fast as they can. Normal, when you do that and your things are normal, it sounds like this. So you hear that rushing sound. But what we want after abductory injections is to hear a little noise. So we want either a little noise like that, or sometimes even a where you hear a little louder noise. And that tells us we've hit our target muscles. Now, in order for you to work most effectively with your doctor, including through those voicemail samples, you both have to be clear on the difference between spasm and Botox side effect, and you have to be able to communicate those to each other. Every now and again, we work with a patient who really has difficulty distinguishing the difference, and this is where that voicemail system is particularly important. Now, let me just mimic quickly some of the various phenomenologies. So a classic kind of moderate severity adductory SD might be like that, with the phonatory S, or the kind of squeezing like that. With there's another variant where the voice is just kind of squeezed all the time. There isn't a lot of phonatory arrest, but there's that squeezing kind of quality like that. That's another variant, and those are spasms. Abductory, the classic, is that the person is talking along like that and the voice just drops way to whisper like that. But there's also a more tonic variant where the voice just sounds kind of breathy and there may be a little instability as well, but there's just this kind of constant, a little bit of a breathy kind of quality. And then there's AD with a lot of tremor, where the voice not only has the catching, but it's kind of shaky like that. And you hear on a sustained voice, you'll hear a e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e-e, where there's tremor and catching. Now, this might be a mild Botox effect, where the voice has what I call a soft edge. It's faintly breathy, but it's still very functional. A moderate voice might be like this, and if you've push that voice, it might break a little like that. That isn't a spasm. That's just the voice giving way or cracking because of my pushing too hard. If I just back off and allow it to be a quiet voice like that, those little breaks and will be less. Now, a severe Botox effect would be like this, where the person is just whispering and they have hardly any voice at all. And the voice, the pitch sometimes goes kind of high like that. Now, the last phenomenology is again that for the abductory. Well, we've summarized here the basic conditions for success: easy access to injections, kind of on demand, straightforward injections, not terribly painful, fairly consistent results, a regular rhythm of injections, about 3 times per year for most people, optimal dosing so that side effects aren't frustrating for the first week or so, and the ability to distinguish between spasm and Botox side effect, Botox effect. So now let's look at optimization of Botox results in a little different way, by looking at some common frustrating scenarios and then seeing what the solution might be. first problem is poor access. You call for an injection and you're told, we can't get you in for a month or for 6 weeks or 2 months. Well, most places will inject at least once a month, and so the solution is simply to always make your next appointment at the time of your injection. So as you're checking out, you get your next injection set up on the schedule. If injections are offered only monthly, instead of we do ours weekly, but you prefer a 3.5 month interval, then this might mean that you have to get your injections every 3 months, 12 weeks, rather than your preferred 14 weeks. But 12 weeks for you would usually work better than having to wait till 16 weeks when your spasms are quite bad, or even 20 weeks if they can't get you in at the 4 month mark because you didn't make the appointment at the time of your prior injection. Second problem is underdosage. Occasionally a person says that the spasms do go away or they diminish greatly, but they don't have any weakness. If I have this kind of a voice as my baseline SD, and I go straight to this kind of a voice where it sounds reasonably good, but occasionally still is a little tight, like I'm doing now, then we'd expect that you might only get 6 or 8 weeks before you're needing another injection. So the simple solution is a bigger dose. Third problem would be overdosage. This is the person who says, every time I get injected, I either whisper like this, or I sound way high like this after, like Minnie Mouse. Or they'll say, I spend a week or two coughing on liquids. Well, the solution there is a lower dose. And remember again that for most people it works best you do need to go to a mild breathiness or a moderate breathiness, but you don't need more than that. A higher dose could give you an extra week or two on the back end, and that's why some people request kind of a high dose. But the reasonable question is, well, what's the point if you lose a week or two of functional voice at the beginning? So most clinicians will either suggest, if you're getting that excessive weakness or Minnie Mouse voice, a smaller dose, or they'll respond to your gentle request for a lesser dose. I think we're up to the fourth scenario, is variability, where the person says that we use the same dose each time, but the side effects and the benefit are very different. Well, that kind of problem means you need to work with your physician to find some kind of stereotype technique. For persons with very difficult anatomy, we sometimes go so far as to mark the chart with a skin crease and its relation to where where we want to do the injection. We talk about creases and moles and so forth. Or we even will go so far, especially with the AB, as to write down the kind of angulation of the needle and try to get the chair, the head position, the same each time. So stereotype, make it the same each time. Now, some find very frustrating to match Botox therapy to important occasions in their lives, which don't tend to be scheduled with your voice and your Botox schedule in mind. So sometimes those important events even come up unannounced. And in that case, it's perfectly appropriate to alter your usual dose and timing. For example, you might perhaps request a half or less of your usual dose if something is coming up in the next few days or the next week or so. Of course, the following injection will come a little earlier, but for many, this is a worthwhile trade-off. We've even had a few who've learned while they're at the peak of their Botox benefit, maybe they're in at 8 weeks, and they're really liking their voice, and they suddenly learn that they have to travel overseas and be away for 3 months. Well, in that case, it's perfectly appropriate to get an early injection, even while the voice is perfect and without any spasms at all. And this is another place where your gentle explanation of your thinking to your clinician will help him or her understand your rationale. Now, one other scenario is the person with a large tremor component. So Botox tends to mute spasms reasonably well, and it often does help a lot with a dystonic tremor, but occasionally the tremor component is so large that the person says, well, I get rid of my spasms, but I still have quite a bad voice problem because my voice is so shaky. So they might say, let's just mimic again, let's say the voice is like this, where there's a lot of shaking of the voice and occasional spasms like that. And so they have their Botox, and then they just go to a voice like this, so they don't have the spasms anymore, but they're still shaking quite a bit. Well, unfortunately, Botox, again, doesn't manage all tremor well, and sometimes we need to try something like propranolol. SD is a frustrating disorder, but Botox therapy that is really optimized can be of great benefit. If that hasn't been the case for you up to this point, I'm hoping that this discussion has provided some ideas that you can take to your physician and discuss and that might help. Thank you very much for listening.